So, here we are, 1 week further down the line. Or in my case, at least, 1 week since my last video on this subject. Which means, yes, it's Thursday, and I've just come in from being out the front, clapping with everyone else for our frontline services. If I sound a bit odd, it's because my lips are chapped, and what I'm about to do is probably not going to help the situation. Which is namely this. This is from Daya. And yeah. I don't think I've had this one before, or I've had one of its relatives, so to speak. And I'm not doing a very good job of this. Because I'm tired, feeling run down. And I think it's the case that, what is this? This is 6.2% and it's called Something Good 3. If you're interested. Quite a number of people that I talk with, colleagues, friends, are about as run down as me. And I think it's not really down to the work that we're doing, it's the whole situation overall. People seem to be worried, and there isn't that much information to actually get a handle on things with. I've really screwed this up. Yes, it's got a nice bit of flavour to it. When I did Pub in a Box on Vimeo, because I don't think I published that on YouTube, I went through Pub in a Box and somebody commented that IPAs can frequently be not very flavoursome. I agree, there's quite a few out there that aren't. And it turns out that the I seem to be having better luck with the higher alcohol contents, the dippers. And yeah, you certainly get a good, whereas the others are 330 mil. This is how much in this? I can't actually read it because I haven't got the right glasses on. It's more than 330 mil, I can tell you that one, but bugger it. I'm getting off the subject, which is perhaps the subject. What's going on seems to be a lot of misinformation out there. And what is coming our way is coming from politicians, which these days we seem to be able to trust less and less. Yeah. So, I'm tired. A lot of my friends and colleagues are tired. It's amazing just how many people are still doing their day jobs just to keep society running. You could start naming them, but I could spend half an hour happily listing off shopkeepers, delivery drivers, shelf stackers, and I would still miss people that are still part of society and keeping everything ticking. It sort of hit me a bit even more when Monday I had another flat tire. And yeah, four flat tires in 4 months. This has cost me a fortune. And yeah, I called up the tire repair company and they were still running. I had a van with me in 3 hours and the tire was swapped out. Sorted. This really is a very surreal situation to be in. And I'm having a problem getting my head around what is reality at the moment. Because it all seems so grey. Things that you expect would be shut are still running, and things that you hoped would still be running are shut. And this situation really does seem to have brought out the best in many people and the worst in some. How are we coping? Reasonably well, given the situation. It's not easy at the moment to get on any sort of list for food. The local supermarket closed off its... I've always made the effort to get Mum to the supermarket. It gets her out of the house, gets her a little bit of exercise. Okay, it lengthens the shopping by a few hours. That is an exaggeration. But it's... I've always tried to get Mum to the shops, so we've never had to sign up for home delivery or anything. I always viewed it as being something which was not only costly, but the particular slots that we could actually, you know, that would be most convenient when I'm home of an evening or on a weekend, those were the most expensive slots. And you're always taking a chance on substitutions and things like that. And if you were getting fresh fruit or veg, you were relying on the picker. And so it was always easier, really, to go to the supermarket. But consequentially, we're not registered for anything online, which means that now we do need to register for stuff online. They've just closed down online registration. Can't do anything. There is actually a vulnerable list, but this household doesn't qualify to be on it, so we've got to fend for ourselves. But we're fortunate in that a number of friends have slots, and they're helping not only us, but other friends out with getting the little bits and pieces that are necessary just to keep life going. There are still a lot of restrictions on a lot of shopping, but we do have a local shop here, which I'm probably going to have to use at some point. I think I've only been in there about 4 or 5 times since I've been in the village, you know, more than 10 years. Yeah, that's going to have to change. And the supermarket is just bonkers. I mean, if I went there when they open at 7 o'clock, the queues are just, forget about it. And even when I managed to get my lunch hour and go down, the queues to get in are running all the way around the supermarket, out into the road and to another junction, even at lunchtime. Even after all the morning rush people have been in and picked the shelves clean. But I'm going to have to go down tomorrow and see what I can get. See what's there. There is another supermarket which, as of today, wasn't doing the queuing thing. As of tomorrow, I don't know. Everything's changing on a day-by-day basis. And that's one thing which is really fueling the uncertainty side of things. We just don't know what's going to be available. It sort of does make you realize to a degree what we had before all this started. And yeah, it's still got a while to play yet. Our official lockdown review for the UK will be in another, well, week and a half, I think. But the way things are looking, I think it's going to be extended. Honestly, the number of people going out in cars over the last couple of days, I was really expecting an extension of the lockdown. In other words, more police patrols stopping people in cars and asking them what they're doing out of their house. That may yet be to come. I don't know. We've already got reports that the police have pretty much put lower level crime on the back burner. So we're going to see what happens with that and take it from there, I guess. Did I finish this? Or is there more in there? There's a bit more in there. Yeah. So, life itself, I think if things don't get lifted in another few weeks to make shopping easier, then we could end up having problems. There have been some restrictions which have been lifted on some products, but not on all. And I think it's still going to be a fluid situation. It does sort of stun me to a degree when looking into this, that this kind of thing that has happened with coronavirus has pretty much been on the top of threat level radar for so long, and the supermarkets just were totally unprepared. I mean, they've got the data. They know who buys what, how often, and how much. They also know which products are critical for certain sections of the population. For example, gluten-free products and certain lactose intolerance. The soy products are critical, pretty much. And there's a number of different products that certain segments of society are reliant on, because for various reasons they can't eat a lot of the other stuff that's on the shelves. And the supermarket should have been protecting those. When stocks of those started to go below a certain level in the shops, they should have stopped selling them to people who didn't regularly buy them. You know, they've got the data. They've got the ability to do this. And yet they seem to be totally unprepared for this. Totally unprepared. If anything, they do seem to be profiteering from this, at least from my viewpoint, because the prices have gone up. The amount that I'm spending just on very basic stuff is what? It's got so bad that I actually had to get toothpaste by mail order. What? And by the time that that's arrived, things have changed again on the shopping front. It's totally bonkers. People are asking questions, and obviously there are no answers. Society itself will provide its own answers in time. Like tonight, us going out and applauding. It's, who is it really affecting, and what will it really change? And once all this crisis is over, what will happen in society? Society right now is of the mood that the wages of frontline NHS staff and a lot of the key workers who keep our country running should be raised. Once this is all over, will society maintain this push, maintain these newfound morals, or will everything just fall apart again and go back to as it was until the next crisis? There are various employers who have not treated their workers very well, despite the assistance that's been put forward by the government. And there are some elements of society that have created some boycott lists. And I suppose that's one of the questions. will society actually boycott these places, their businesses, once all this is over? Or will it be still back to, oh, they've got the cheapest trainers, or their pub meals are reasonably cheap? I'm talking about what's his name, Sports and Wetherspoons, and there's others like them. Or will everything go back to being as it was before? That's the big question for society, I think, and only time is going to tell that. Or will enough people actually continue the push that, you know, there's something wrong here and it needs to be righted, and sufficient push come from society to make that change happen? Only time is going to answer that question. At the moment, I think most of us are in survival mode, just trying to get through this. There is one thing that some people seem to be watching for, me included, which is how much food gets wasted as a result of all the panic buying that's been going on. As most of the stuff has been flying off the shelves, has been long life milk, pasta, and that sort of thing. I don't know. There hopefully shouldn't be that much wastage. But what did happen about a week ago, and it was highlighted by one nurse who came off a long shift, went to try and get some fresh fruit and veg, and everything was picked bare. How much of that is going to turn up in the refuse? Are we actually going to find out? How is society going to react? I mean, there's already been one thing that did hit the press, but that may possibly have been fake news. Oh, pardon me. We're going to have to find out. There's a few things that I sort of have been able to pull together and that do concern me. There's going to be some links in the hoo-ha bar for you to review yourself and draw your own conclusions, because I certainly am not qualified to give anyone to tell anyone anything. I'm in the same position as everybody else. It's a damn good job I'm just sticking to one can of this. I think the worry is really getting to me, you know. The first thing that worries me is link number one, which is to the herd immunity plan. Now, from what I can guess from this, or not guess, gather from this, is that this appears to be like the flu. In other words, the only reason that the flu doesn't kill as many people anymore is because most of us have had it, we've got some immunity to it, so it doesn't kill as many people because our bodies have seen it, we've got vaccines and all the rest of that jazz. The first time that the flu must have hit us, was it like this back then? I mean, there have been a number of epidemics of various flus and various bits and pieces, but there are so many different strains of the same things, and I'm finding it hard to actually keep up. But what I'm reading is, this is a Guardian article from the 15th of March. It seems that our government has decided that the spread of coronavirus in the population to levels creating herd immunity is inevitable, and indeed desirable. However, on the basis of China and indeed South Korea, where by stringent measures the spread of the virus was halted in its tracks at a relatively low level, massive population spread is not inevitable. We have not been told why such a policy, by contrast, is not appropriate for the UK. It goes on a bit. But part of me is left thinking that the population has no choice. That we are all going to have to get this in various forms, or the vaccine against it, which will be 1 to 2 years down the line, possibly, in order to then get immunity from it. In other words, from what I'm reading, I'm concluding that the coronavirus is going to be part of our society just as the flu is part of our society and part of our everyday lives. So that is a concern, particularly concerning my mother. It really does read to me that I have no point and no choice but to bring this back home at some point in time. And that the only reason for the isolation is to prevent us all getting infected at the same time, overwhelming the health service, who might actually be able to save a few of us who otherwise would have died. In other words, rather than everybody getting it over and done with and quite a few people dying, it's going to be spread out. We're still going to all have to get it, but hopefully more people will be saved. That's how I'm interpreting what I'm reading. I think there's going to still be a degree of backlash for Boris Johnson as to why he was happy for the herd immunity thing to happen, and then about a week down the line saying, oh no, we need to isolate and spread the curve and save a few lives. The initial thing of let everybody have it and let people die, that's going to come back and bite him. Indeed, there's the argument that it already did, because he's contracted COVID-19. Coronavirus. COVID-19. Yeah, I know, there's technical stuff in there. So, yeah. The other thing is the cause of this. Link number two is going to be a link to a video by Lahaway 86, Sea Milk, Matthew Tai. The video is titled, I Found the Source of the Coronavirus. What he's done is he has... Now, you can... The tone of his video, he takes about 2 to 3 minutes to really vent off some anger at China blaming other countries before actually starting to get to the nuts and bolts of it. And he does chop a few other things up over time. To reverse the video, basically he has gone through various public websites in China, and he has pulled information back from those websites, which is key information. From that information that he's gathered from the publicly accessible data in China, 280 meters away from the Wuhan wet market was the laboratory. In that laboratory was running a team which was headed up by a very prominent and well-known an experienced scientist in the realm of coronavirus bat infection, so much so that she was apparently named Batwoman. There were some adverts, some job adverts, at the tail end of last year, and one of which at the 24th of December 2019 was basically the case of, we've found something. My microphone's playing up here. Which is basically the case of, we've found something. We need extra people to help us sort this out. And it looks like there was a lab accident. Now, link number three is going to be to an article basically about lab accidents. Where the heck did I put it? It's on disease, contagious, why are highly contagious diseases kept in labs? I don't want to put that in Chromium, I want to put that in Firefox. In fact, did I put it here? Yes, I did. The article is basically, why are highly contagious diseases kept in labs? There are other links in this article which will take you through to other things, and you can go down the rabbit holes as you wish. From 2008 to through 2012, more than 1,000 laboratory incidents occurred that posed a risk to humans or animals. Many of these reported incidents were minor, but some were serious enough that lab workers needed medical attention. Because of bioterrorism laws, the names and locations of labs weren't released, but USA Today obtained incident reports from the CDC. The accidents included ones in which workers and animals were inadvertently infected, in some cases with bacteria and viruses that can have serious complications. Now, from what I've been reading, in order to study many of these viruses and other things, the labs will actually make more and more concentrated forms of the viruses that they're studying in order that they've got more material that's easier to study. And lab accidents are not unknown, so it's entirely plausible, given what I'm reading, that yes, there was an accident in a Wuhan lab that released this coronavirus on the world. It's made even more compelling by the fact that one of the lab assistants is missing. Officially, she's supposed to be alive and well, but where is she? And there's pretty much a hunt on for where is she. The Chinese government and the laboratory itself is saying, yeah, she's alive, she's alive. But the easiest way to scotch the rumour, as Matthew says, is to produce her, is to show her to the ear. Here she is. But that hasn't happened. And the Chinese government would loves to scotch rumours and keep everything under control. So yeah, things smell quite fishy there. Now, there are some comments below the video of various other people saying, I also read Chinese and what's in this video is true. And if you follow the links, then it seems plausible that these people are acting in good faith. In other words, they're not simply sock puppets for Matthew. So it's up to you to follow your own nose down that one and study whatever it is that you wish to study and believe of this what you wish to believe. There's not much else I can say, really. My lips are going bonkers. But honestly, right now, I don't care. from what I've been reading, the rabbit holes that I've limitedly followed, that isn't proper English, but you know what I mean, that is the most it's the most convincing explanation for how the coronavirus got released on the world. As for the people in Wuhan who took medication in order to evade the travel bans, escaped Wuhan and traveled to other countries, lock them up and throw away the key. It was the most reckless thing that I can. Those people have just.
Yeah.
Irresponsible to the nth degree. So. I haven't seen anything. Of all the theories and things that I've read and seen, Matthews does seem to be the most solid explanation of what's going on, or how it all started. How this all finishes is another matter. There are so many unknowns and questions that I really don't have the answers to. And that, I think, is really having an effect on quite a number of people. The other thing, of course, is how much of an effect it has on society. We're already seeing unprecedented changes. The number of businesses that the social isolation has ruined just continues to rack up, despite government intervention. The financial institutions that were bailed out in the 2008 disaster have tried to, well, let's put it this way. The government seems to have given money to these institutions to pass on to the population, to keep money running, to keep the economy working. And all that these institutions have done is basically ramped up the barriers to make this stuff difficult to get hold of. Businesses that need to get hold of the loans have got to offer personal collateral to get the money. And mortgages. The entry level to mortgages has just got much, much higher. Nationwide hit the press earlier on this week, I think it was, by upping the equity requirement, upping the down payment in order for them to even entertain a mortgage. That is going to be a massive body blow to the market if other lenders follow suit. I'm in a bit of a tiz because I'm caught in the middle of that, because I'm in the middle of renegotiating my mortgage. Despite the interest rates being at a record low of 0.1% in the UK right now. In theory, this should make mortgages cheaper. And instead, the entry level has just been shot through the roof. Once we get through all this, and we will, in one way or another, society is going to be changed. The trick is that a number of people quite a number of people are going to be so damaged by this. And some people have lost their jobs. They cannot get the assistance because the services have been overwhelmed. And I think that the US has been overwhelmed in pretty much the same way that the UK has, in the number of people who normally claim unemployment benefit just going off the scale. So the number of staff doesn't exist in the service to cope with the amount of people coming forward. There are going to be so many individuals hurt personally by this that you couldn't blame them really having a grudge against society and thus continuing the selfish behavior exhibited by the hoarders at the start of this whole lockdown thing. It's too complicated to call. Far too complicated to call. Are we going to change as a society? Are we going to suddenly... Is somebody going to call... Once this is over and things have settled, is somebody going to call a no-confidence vote in Boris Johnson and get him kicked out? And get a general election called? And if a general election was called, we're in the same situation now as we were a few months ago when we called the last general election in December. There's still nobody really of enough of a trustworthy political force in order for the population to get behind. Our Labour Party is led by Jeremy Corbyn, or was. Jeremy Corbyn is now out. The Labour Party has got to elect a new leader. There is a chance that whoever ends up leading the Labour Party could potentially draw enough favour to attract the voters if they are more socially minded at the time as a result of all this. So there could potentially be a lot more political upheaval to come. As we stand at the moment, there's a lot of uncertainty. Previously, it was uncertainty which was outside the bubble. In other words, this is what I need to survive and lead a comfortable life. Politics and the rest of it is going on is outside that bubble. All this has penetrated that bubble and I'm now in the position where I'm wondering, can I actually get the food that is needed in order for this household to survive? And if I can survive today, can we survive tomorrow? And I'm telling you, the only reason that we are surviving right now is due to the assistance of other people. You know, people are helping each other out. It's amazing what's going on right now. It is sort of reminiscent of what I was reading about war times, of how people came together. But even though people came together, even during the world wars, there were people who took advantage. The other big issue is that is the freedoms that are being given up right now, the powers that are being given to government. Will those powers ever be rescinded once this emergency is over? In theory, at the moment, these powers last 2 years with a review every 6 months. And the 6 month review was hard fought for in Parliament. There's a lot of uncertainty. My faith at the moment is in people. That's where my faith lies. My faith lies in the people that I know and trust, and acting together, pretty much, to support each other through all this. Yeah. For the next video, I think I'm going to have to change the audio cable, because I think this one is finally giving up the ghost and playing up, which is disappointing to me, because this, as far as I'm concerned, is an important video for me. Important for you, I don't know. But yeah, I think that subsequent videos will probably be of this nature, will probably be on Vimeo only. There are a few other videos which are on Vimeo only, and part of that is down to YouTube. We're being forced over to the new YouTube interface, which I'm not a fan of, for various reasons. I've fed that back to YouTube time after time. Whenever you switch to Classic View, you give your reasons. I think one of my principal concerns is that if there is a copyright strike against a video, there's no easy warning sign. It should be in bright red letters. Warning, warning, there's been a copyright strike. But that doesn't exist. And yeah, my faith in YouTube is knackered. So anyway, take a look at the links, see what you think, and take it from there, really. But I think it's going to be a case of day by day now. I've literally heard from a number of people now over the last couple of weeks that they're just going to stop watching so much of the news. So some of them are now just going to do the news once a week as a sort of a catch-up. And not, because staying on top of everything and on top of the figures and reading all the panicky, negativity stuff and the, oh my God, there's been so many deaths, it's actually harming their health. It's harming their mental health. So where do you go? What do you do? Detach from the bigger picture. Keep yourself in good health and ensure that you have the ability to survive this. So all I can do is say, stay safe, people. Take care of yourselves. There is the only thing that we seem to know at the moment is that there's an awful lot that we don't know. Yeah. The one thing I do know is that I need to look at this sodding cable, because it's definitely not right. See you on the next one. Take care of yourselves. Ciao for now.